Go up 931 north, just before you get North Street, on it would be on the east side of this road, that you have the gas place, the rental place, and then Cross America. And that's where the graduation award's going to be. 22nd workday this month. Appreciate those who came out last workday. Then the 23rd is Family Day, and again, election church officer. VBS, do you want to have a meeting this morning? Okay, so we'll have a short meeting after the communion this morning for Vacation Bible School. But remember, that's coming up July the 11th through 15th. That sounds like a long way off. About that quick, it'll be here. That's just the way things are going right now. So have that in mind. If you can help, stay around for the Vacation Bible School meeting. We'll get you plugged in. Reminder, there's a box under the coat for Underwear Sunday. That doesn't mean Dress Up Sunday for us or Dress Down Sunday. We're collecting underwear items for the mission, and that will go through the 23rd. If you want to donate something, just bring it in, put it in that box. That's for children K through 12. All right, that's enough announcing. So let's sing hymn number 48, Stand If You're Able, as Bruce comes to lead us.
48.
Tim, would you please lead us this morning?
Heavenly Father, we're thankful, Lord, that we can be here this morning. Lord, we just ask that your spirit would be in and around to each and every heart. Lord, ask that you would be able to ask what you want us to do.
Somehow we've made it like some of us surrender, but we need to surrender. So pat on the back to us.
Glorified and honored.
Aaron Rodgers, that situation.
Amen. All right, you may be seated. It's that most exciting time of our service, the penny mark.
62 in your hymnal 62.
I love thee, Lord Jesus, I adore thy name. great song. It's not as loud or not as high pitched as that other one we sang. That's a pretty good. Pastor would pray that they would write them a little bit lower, but I'd pray that God would give me a voice that I could sing them.
Well, that's true.
We need both of those, don't we?
Yeah.
All right. Well, we're glad that you're here this morning. Take a quick look. And I know I do this every Sunday, take a quick look at the offering report. And we did very good. We thank the Lord for that. We want to use those terms of very good or not so good, you know. But anyway, we're just thankful for how God blesses in stewardship. And the reason why I go through these things, you know, every week is, you know, remember as a kid, you learned that there's the eye gate and there's the ear gate, you know. Then as I was growing up, we heard about Watergate and all those kinds of things, you know. But that's an entirely different subject. But it helps sometimes just to go through and make sure we understand what's in the bulletin. Missionary of the Week is the Gardeners, John and Paula, and they're with the Amazing Grace Mission Fair Ministry. And if you've ever met them, they're a wonderful people. They got their... I always remember their booth at the fair, and they have a lot of novel ways of getting your curiosity. If you know, come into their booth, and they have you know, things like what can't God do, you know, and you think, well, you know, what is that? I thought God could do everything, and you can go in there and find out what it is, and then you look into a thing. It's a box, and it's got a mirror or something, and I don't remember. There's just a lot of different things they use to reach people at the fairs for the cause of Christ. Here a while back, I think it was, I don't know how long ago it was, Pastor was down with his family making investments in the economy of Florida, and I brought a message on Nabal and David, and you remember the story was, or the account was in the scripture that and Nabal was an individual who was a very successful farmer. He worked hard and all these kinds of things. And yet David had overseen the watch care of his flocks. He had overseen the watch care of Nabal's employees and so forth. And when it came time for them to give a little bit of a stip, for him to give a little bit of a stipend to David and his men, Nabal kind of had an attitude that a lot of people have today. And just to paraphrase what he said, he says, "Why should I take my bread and water and give it to men coming from who knows where?" And someone has said, there is an old saying that if you give your resources to good causes, you'll be known as a generous person. But if you keep it for yourself, you're going to be seen as a fool. I think those words are rather blunt, but I think they're probably more true than what we would like to admit. Some people go to a great extent to defend a kind of a miserly, tight-fisted attitude. And so those kinds of people will say things, I'm not going to put my money in the collection plate if I can't get a tax deduction for it. Or that's good that we can get that, but that's not the basis for it, I hope, anyway. I'm not going to give my money unless I'm sure exactly where every penny of it goes. I think we would really be surprised to find out where a lot of our money goes that we spend for other things that besides the church. But these are really not the statements, I don't think, of a good steward. I think they're probably more the excuses of somebody like Nabal, whose name, by the way, as you remember from our study, means fool. David's men had not entered into any kind of a contractual agreement with Nabal, so he wasn't going to provide any food or supplies for them. And Nabal was one of these real careful kinds of people, almost to a fault. Well, actually, to a fault. And he wasn't going to set his money afloat on something or some group that he didn't care about. No one was going to take advantage of old Nabal when it come to his money. He said, you know, in a sense, he says, who knows who this character David is and what he and his men will do with my hard-earned money that I give him for all that he's done for me. As a result, Nabal failed to invest in the very place that God is actually at work in his world. I think we ought to be careful stewards. I really do. I think we need to be careful about where we put our money as far as giving for the Lord's causes. I think we need to be very careful about how we give money towards any kind of a cause that way. We used to have a lady in our church up in Michigan years ago. Her name was Alice. Alice Goolsby, I'll never forget her. She was a black lady. We had a number of black folks in our church. But Alice had the attitude, she says, you know, when it comes to the tithe, she says, everybody tithes. And I used to think about that. Well, I don't know if everybody tithes or not. And then she further went on and said, you know, you either tithe to the hospital, or you tithe to the mechanic, or you tithe to some other place that's besides the church. You're just not going to escape your responsibility.
Right.
And you know, do I subscribe necessarily to what Alice Goolsby said? It doesn't really make any difference. Alice was convinced in her mind and heart, and she said by experience she had learned this. So I'm not going to argue with her when it comes to that particular thing. We do need to be careful stewards, but if we never practice generosity because we have never really found that perfect cause, everything's just exactly the way we want it to be, and it's all the ducks are in a row, so to speak, then what happens is we get into the same kind of an attitude of foolishness that Nabal got into. With wisdom, this morning we give. With wisdom of how God's going to be, the cause of Christ is going to be blessed, the church is going to be blessed, and the responsibilities that we have as a fellowship of believers is going to be taken care of. So we ought to give. Give with wisdom. Give with an open heart and open hands. May the Lord bless you this morning as we receive our offering. So men, if you'll come at this time, thankful for each one of you that's here with us this morning. If you are visiting with us today, you are our guest. We're not putting the pinch on you. The rest of you, we are putting the pinch on you. I don't know what else to say. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Jesus. What a blessing. We love you, Lord, today. We could never pay you for all that you do for us, and that's not our intention today. We're just thankful, Father, that we have been blessed as we have been blessed. And we're thankful for who you are and what you mean to us. So bless now the offering in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Our study in John's Gospel, but we're not done with the Bible yet. It's a big book, and there's a lot of stuff that we can cover. Amen. I've decided to do a topical study for the next few weeks. This is one that I've done before, but it's one that I am super, super, super passionate about. All right? It is the question of whether or not Adam had a belly button. No, not really. Chew on that one now, the rest of the service. I probably just lost some of you because you're going to be thinking about that the whole service. I want to speak for the next few weeks, Lord willing, on the subject of worship. How many of you in this room are praying for, longing for revival? We sense that things aren't quite the way that they ought to be in our church and in churches in general. And so we crave
I don't want to say something more because you have to be careful. If you're putting experiences over the absolute truth of God's word, you have to take care. But if you, for example, read the book of Acts and you use that as an overlay of what is happening in a lot of churches today, we say, oh, they're just not matching up there. Amen? The desire we have is for God to do the supernatural in our midst. And again, I'm not talking about signs and wonders. I'm talking about the conversion of rebels into worshipers. And that's what we're going to be talking about is the subject of worship. Because here's what I believe. What we really need is a revival of putting God in his rightful place. We need a revival of attention to him. We need a revival of obedience to him. We need a revival of trust towards him. And I think that that's one reason why the subject of worship is so important. It's because it is, as it were, putting God in his rightful place. And at the same time, putting ourselves in our rightful place. And I can tell you what our rightful place is not. We are not God. And he is. He is to be exalted, and we should be abased or humbled. Another reason that we're going to look at this topic, and we do occasionally, just like every once in a while I do a series on the family, is because there is a lot of weird ideas about what worship is. One of the most common ideas out there is that worship is, it's a time where we sing and we praise the Lord. Now I can tell you this much, that may or may not be part of worship. All right? A lot of it depends on what's going on in our hearts that nobody can see. We don't have the, I call it whoop-de-doo music. We don't have the whoop-de-doo music, all right? We don't have the gospel hootenanny stuff. But here's the reality. When we sing, we may or may not be worshiping, because just the act of singing is not necessarily worship. Right. So we're going to spend, again, a few weeks looking at the subject of worship. We'll spend a little bit of time in John chapter 4, if you want to head that way. I was going to read through verse 24, but if I read all that, it'll be time to dismiss by the time we get through it. So we'll start with just one verse, verse 24 of John chapter 4. I just give you a little quick background. Jesus says to the disciples, I must needs go through Samaria. The reason he needed to go through Samaria, which by the way was not a way that the Jews went. And he talked to a woman. He wasn't supposed to do that by Jewish standards. But there was a woman there that needed the water of life. And so Jesus goes through there, he meets this woman at the well, they get into a theological discussion, which was for her just a way to try to divert the true issue here. And they start talking about worship. In verse 20, our fathers worship in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. And by the way, that's point number one we're not going to look at this morning, but God wants worship. That verse says that he seeketh such to worship him. And then verse 24, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, eventually we'll look at what that means, but let me start this morning really not dealing with the subject of worship per se, but it's related. Here's the fundamental truth. There ought to be a difference between Christians and non-Christians. Now, I don't mean a weird difference, okay? I don't think we don't need to be weird, but there ought to be a fundamental difference in our lives as Christians. A difference from those who are in the world. People should be able to observe our lives and see a distinctiveness about them. Our values and our pursuits ought to be different than those around us. And you know why? Because we are different. For example, we have a different father. Jesus told the Pharisees, "Ye are of your father the devil." In contrast, Paul says about Christians in Romans 8:15, "For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father." For a Christian, the devil is not our father, God is our father. We have different fathers. Galatians 4:6, "And because you are sons, God hath sent forth his spirit, the spirit of his son, into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father." So we have a different father. Secondly, we have a different walk, and by that I mean a different way of living life, all right? For example, we walk in light rather than darkness. I was talking to Chris about this the other day. He says he likes his rooms dark. I said, well, ever since I got saved, I haven't liked darkness. I don't know if that says anything about him or not. You have to make your own deduction there. All right. We walk in light rather than darkness. John chapter 3, verse 18 through 21. "He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light," that should be a capital L there because it's talking about Jesus, "light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God." Paul said in Colossians 3:1-13, "Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son." So we, those of us who know Christ, we no longer walk in darkness, but we walk in the light. We have a different master. Romans chapter 6, verse 6, "Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth," that means from now on, "we should not serve sin." Verse 11, "Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord." So we have a different master. We no longer, at least should be, we no longer serve sin. Fourthly, we now have life where once we had death. Ephesians 2, 1 through 6, Paul's rehearsing the old life, he says, "And you hath he quickened," the word means made alive, "who were dead in trespasses and sins, where in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom we had our conversation times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as others." Then those two most wonderful words, "but God." who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us again, made alive us together with Christ. By grace are you saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places. So we now have life where once we possessed death, we have new destinations. The unsaved are hell bound. I read this in my personal devotions this morning. It breaks my heart. It breaks my heart because there is a literal hell that people will literally go to and will literally be punished forever. Revelation 20, 11 through 15, and I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death, and whosoever was found, who was not found written in the book of life, was cast into the lake of fire. In contrast to the destination of the damned or the unsaved, the saved have heaven to look forward to. Revelation 21, 1 through 5, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be, this is the good stuff, folks, no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. Those of us who know the Lord Jesus Christ, we have a different destination. It's not hell. Hallelujah, it's heaven. Amen. And I told men I was praying with this morning, I don't have a death wish, but it don't look so bad. Amen? Why as believers do we act like death is bad when it really is the ultimate promotion? We're going to a place where there's no sickness, no pain, no crying, no more partying, no more funerals, no more getting up in the morning and wondering if it's going to work or not. If you start getting older, you know what I mean. That's the destination of those who are saved. The reality is we have nothing in common with the unsaved where it matters. That's why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 6, 14 through 18, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with what unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? And what part hath he that believeth with an infidel or a non-believer? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them and be separate, saith the Lord. And by the way, it doesn't say be like them so you can win them. It says, come out from among them, be ye separate, saith the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Dramatic pause. I need to catch my breath. We are to be distinctively different from those around us because the spiritual realm is where reality is, and we are greatly different. The question is, are we different? As we look at our society, what do we see? What are people's values? What are they living for? What do they seek? And you know, today, some people think Jesus is coming because America is getting bad. He may be coming, and I hope he is. But at other times in history and other places, it's been bad also. We might be quick to say that this is a wicked society and very sinful and ungodly, and that is true. And they may be worse than any generation, I don't know. Fact is, we do live in an exceedingly wicked time, and maybe even the last times described by Paul in 2 Timothy 3, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. You know, my conviction is that the last times are from the time that Jesus left until now. But we might be in the last of the last times, I don't know. What we are seeing is an amplification of man's sinful ways. What we're witnessing is a turning in mass away from the God of heaven. With an apathetic yawn concerning spiritual things, it's almost as if I don't care at all what you're telling me. And a lot of it's because the spirit of the world. In 1 John 2, we are warned not to love the world or the things of the world. Then the characteristics of that love of the world are broken down into three categories. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world, and the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. The three areas that John touches on this passage are the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. The things of the world may be desired and possessed for uses and purposes that God intended. They may be used by His grace for His glory. I'm not advocating not having possessions or not having a measure of pleasure in this life. But believers must not seek or value them for purposes to which sin abuses them. Now here's the fundamental problem. This is what we're going to be talking about in the days ahead. The world draws the heart away from God. The more the love of the world prevails, the more of the love for God decays. Again, the things of the world are classed according to three ruling inclinations of the depraved nature, the lust of the flesh and the body, wrong desires of the heart, the appetite of indulging all things that excite and inflame sensual pleasures, the lust of the eyes, The eyes are delighted with riches and rich possessions. This is the lust of covetousness. The pride of life, a vain man craves the grandeur and pomp of a vainglorious life that includes the thirst after honor and applause. It's self-exaltation. It's I'm somebody. When the reality is we are nobodies who should be in love with somebody. The pursuit of pleasure, possessions, and pomp is typical of this fallen humanity. That is the love of the world. The culture in which we live is very typical of fallen humanity. America seeks sensual pleasure and material enrichment. In fact, I told the kids in our chapel this the other day, you know what the great American dream that we hear about all the time? It's to get a good education so you can get a good job, so you can have lots of things and have lots of fun. Where's God fit? Americans are concerned about looking good before others. Again, that's typical of those who don't know the Lord. They love the world. They seek the things that the world offers. It's really just a selfish way of living. In fact, it's a deifying of yourself. It's you making yourself a god. Living for pleasure and possessions and pomp. Again, it's understandable when the lost man lives for those values. But as we noted at the beginning of the sermon, Christians ought to be different. We ought to have different values, different desires, different pursuits, and more than anything else, a different focus in life. Whereas the lost man focuses on himself and what the world can give him, the Christian ought to focus on God and our relationship to him. Unfortunately, that's not the way in contemporary Christianity in America. Instead of us focusing on loving God, many Christian Americans are caught up in the love of the world, seeking the same pleasure and power and prestige. I think, and I might be wrong, like that's something amazing, right? But American Christians, for the most part, are just as man-centered as our unsaved counterparts. Christianity in America has adopted a consumer mentality. They pick churches not on the basis of opportunity to love and serve God and help others and learn about Him, but they pick churches on the basis of what that church can do for them and how that can affirm them and make them feel real good. Well, if you want to feel good, don't come here. Just kidding. We can feel good about ourselves, but we go about it the right way. Amen? And we'll be talking about that. There's all this consumer mentality among believers is that many churches cater to that by offering programs that are targeted to meet people's, quote, felt needs, like those are the ultimate. Again, don't get me wrong, the church should meet people's needs, but that should not be the focus, nor should the church be packaged and promoted as someone would market wares for the kitchen countertop. We're not selling toasters, folks. Yeah. The Church of Jesus Christ is a living organism that exists not for the pleasure and benefits of its members foremost, but for the pleasure and glory of God. An emphasis on need meeting is man-centered instead of God-centered. When you have a man-centered emphasis, you simply feed the basic problem of man, which is a world orientation rather than a God orientation. G. Campbell Morgan said, "Religion is that which binds a man. Every man is bound somewhere, somehow, to a throne, to a government, to an authority, to something that is supreme, to something to which he offers sacrifice, burns incense, and bends the knee." In other words, Man is bound by that which he invests in. And you keep that in your mind, because that's how this is related to worship, what you invest in. Be it pleasure seeking one form or another, or seeking of things, or even the seeking of the praise of man. In each of these, man is the center focus. My desire, my things, my reputation. The result is something that J.I. Packer calls, and I love his book about this, but called hot tub religion. He says that hot tub religion is the product of our time. It embodies and reflects the world's way of looking at life. It is, by biblical standards, though both worldly and eccentric. Pleasure conceived and pursued in terms of this world's goods and comforts is the center focus of hot tub religion. He goes on to say, Freudianism has captured Christians no less than post-Christian imaginations with its picture of human individual driven by desperate desire for pleasure, especially sexual pleasure, and likely to come apart at the seams if these desires are not indulged. Humanism has touted individual self-expression, self-discovery, self-realization, self-fulfillment as life's supreme goal. And that's why many Christians can ignore God's laws relating, for example, to premarital or extramarital sex. They are putting their pleasure above what God wants. Christians have taken this thought into their minds and affirmed that this is God's will. After all, God wants me to be happy. Hollywood and TV have projected a fairy tale view of life in which pleasure is the crock of gold you always find at the end of the rainbow, provided that your previous behavior has not been too utterly outrageous. Out of this murky mix of thought, again, Packer says, has emerged hot tub religion, preoccupied with personal pleasure in one form or another, demanding that godliness be soothing, and insisting that whatever eases life tensions must for that reason be good and holy. Now, you just look around, it tells you, you know what I'm telling you is the truth, because this is not popular in today's Christian culture environment. Everybody wants self-affirmation. I want to feel good. I want to have my self-esteem built up. I want to have a good emotional experience. I want to have Lou fun in church. Don't look at me like that. Well, that'll never happen here. This is what hot tub religion is. It's Christianity corrupted by passion for pleasure. It is Christianity trying to beat materialism, Freudianism, humanism, and Hollywood at their own game. That's why it is futile to try to entertain people. We can't compete, folks. We can't do it, nor should we. There's no reason to. We should rather challenge the errors that rules of the game reflect. Christianity, though in short, has fallen victim yet again, for it's happened many times, to the allure of the fallen world. Worldliness, that is, embracing the world's values, in this case pleasure, is the source of hot tub religion's distinctive look or outlook. D.L. Moody said, the place for the ship is in the sea, speaking of the church and the world, but God help the ship if the sea gets into the ship. And I think that's where we are. Symptoms of a hot tub religion today include skyrocketing divorce and remarriage. And by the way, this is one of the reasons why we can't confront the world on the LGBT issue, for example. We got to clean up our own act. Widespread indulgence of sexual aberrations, overheated supernaturalism that seeks signs, wonders, visions, prophecies, and miracles, constant soothing syrup from electronic preachers. And I know you're thinking of one right off the bat. Makes you feel good, right? All that started with Shuler out there in the crystal pistol. Anti-intellectual sentimentalism and emotional highs deliberately cultivated. Packer said the Christian equivalent of cannabis and coca. And an easy, thoughtless acceptance of luxury and everyday living. These are not healthy trends. Because they make the church look like the world. And by the way, you want to measure the American church, let's take it out of here and set it down in a third world culture and see how it fits. I got a hunch they're better Christians. Because we have been corrupted. What is the answer to this creeping invasion of worldliness in the church? Well, John said it, love not the world, neither the things in the world. Why John's admonishment? Because the love of the world excludes the love and worship of the Father. Love of the world is egocentric, acquisitive, arrogant, ambitious, absorbing, leaves no place for any other kind of affection. Those who love the world serve and worship themselves at every moment. It is their full-time job. That's why Jesus said you can't love God and. He said mammon, but you can put anything else in the blank there. God wants your exclusive worship above everything else. You see, it's a matter of focus or what you pay attention to. If you pay attention to the world, in fact, this is one, I ran across this a few months back and I can't get it out of our minds. Nearly every sin we are guilty of can be found in three groups. Number one, sins of disobedience. Sins of distrust, but the one that we don't talk about is sins of distraction, where we allow ourselves to be pulled off and God is no longer the focus. If you pay attention to the world, you cannot pay attention to the God of heaven. The real solution to what ails us then, not more programs, not more preaching, especially the kind that caters to man-centeredness, or more politics, and by politics I mean the manipulation of people. And you can do it. We did it. We did it. Back in the day, the fundamental Baptists, they did a lot of it. They had contests and promotions, and they offered the church just like a door-to-door salesman would sell vacuum cleaners. What is needed in our lives, and I'm talking about every one of us in this room, what is needed in our lives is more of a God focus. And that is what worship is really about. Worshiping God is focusing on Him. It is giving yourself, Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, as a living sacrifice. It's not about me. Yeah. It's about him. And if that sinks into our psyche, we understand that we are expendable. It's not about Mikey's happiness. I try to make it that way. It's about his glory. Worshiping God is focusing on him, his desires rather than our own. His will, not ours. His plan, not ours. His pleasure, not ours. Now, don't get me wrong. Christians are joy-filled, content, peace-filled, hope-filled individuals. We're happy generally when we get this right. Again, Jesus said, if you seek your life, you're going to lose it. If you lose it, then you're going to gain it. The byproduct of this focus, that is a focus on God and worshiping him, is that we will have our needs met. But when we focus on ourselves rather than God, we will not. So starting next week, Lord willing, unless the rapture occurs and then Morris will be preaching. Totally just kidding. Now what, right? He said his sermon title will be After the Rapture. Now what? Starting next week, we'll begin to look at the subject of worship because it is critical. In fact, John MacArthur calls worship the ultimate priority. And I agree with that. But often neglected. But let me stop there and now and speak to those who may not have a relationship to this God that I'm talking about. That is, you are part of that other group that we talked about. You don't have life. You don't have light. You don't have the hope of heaven. The good news is you can change that this morning in an instant. Amen. If you will turn from your sin, and sin, by the way, we want to make lists when we talk about sin. You don't need to make a list. Sin simply, me being my own God, doing whatever I want. That's what sin is. If you will turn from that self-lordship to Jesus Christ in faith, trusting his atonement for your sin, he'll save you that quick. That quick. And everything changes. Well, everything begins to change. Amen? We're not there yet. But everything begins to change. So I encourage you, if you don't know Christ today, you say, well, I don't understand all that. Well, just come. Not that we are brilliant. That's why one of the things encouraged me about the Word of God. He says he uses little things. Not many wise, not many strong. I can fit in there, amen. Not that we got all the answers, but we will open up the book that has all the answers and show you how you can know that you're saved. That you have a real relationship with the living God. And begin. The main transaction takes place here is that you're changed from a rebel, that's what sin is, to a worshiper. That's what salvation's about. We tend to make it about not going to heaven when we die. And that's true, but the main thing is you're restored to what God originally intended for you, and that is to be a worshiper of him. Amen? All right, every head bowed, every eye closed. I don't think we'll have an invitation because we have communion day, but we'll do it this way. How many of you can say by an uplifted hand, Brother Mike, I know I'm saved. I am a worshiper of God through Jesus Christ. I know that. And I lift my hand as a testimony this morning all over the house. So you know you're saved. All right, God bless you. You may put it down. If you could not or should not have raised your hand, Would you let me pray for you this morning? Promise you I won't come to you, won't embarrass you. I'll pray in a generic way, nobody will know it's you. But I'll pray that God will help you come to that assurance of salvation. If that's you, just slip your hand up and down this morning. Say, pray for me, I'm not sure. Lord, thank you. Thank you for the testimony of these folks. And Lord, help us. Lord, we want to get it right. There are so many voices out there telling us that living Christian life means this and it means that. Well, Lord, we want you to tell us what it means. And as we open your word again these next few months, help us, Lord, to perfect our worship. Lord, that it would be, as you said in John 4:24, in spirit and in truth. And we'll thank you for it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, we need to, I don't think we need, I don't want to make it sound like